The Tabletop Bellhop is here to answer your gaming and game night questions.
So tonight's question actually comes by way of Deanna. Deanna is the one that came up with our topic tonight, so I'm going to hand things over to her to get us started.
Well, recently over on Instagram, we were asked the question, do you consider Farkle a real game? And my first thought was, nah, that's a silly question. I mean, I can answer that one pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. And the answer is yes, by the way, Farkle is a real game. But it started me thinking, like, it stuck in my head, and I found myself still thinking about it again, like, a day or two later. Is Farkle a real game? And see, the problem I have with this question is the phrase real game, which implies that some games are real and others aren't. So I thought it would be an interesting discussion. I mean, sure. Mo, what's the Bellhop's first law?
Of course, the first law is the best game in your collections are the ones that actually get to the table, the ones that get played. It doesn't matter how fancy they are, how clever the mechanics are, how awesome the miniatures are, how well-known the designer is, whose name's on the box. What matters the most is if the game gets to the table.
Right. There are no good games and bad games. There's just games. And the games that you're actually getting to the table and having a fun time playing, those are the best games out there.
Fair enough. Yeah, I agree, but I do think... you said there are no good games and bad games, and I agree. Every game has its place, but I will say I think there are good games and bad games for me or for you or for a specific game group or a specific demographic, that not every game is for everyone. We've said that many times, and that's an awesome thing. It's great that there are all these different games that appeal to different people, and I think that is fantastic. Now, because you don't like a game doesn't make it a bad game, and because I love a game doesn't make it a good game for you. Games are awesome. The best game, of course, though, is that one you enjoy and you get played.
So we all agree Tapple After Dark is the best game.
That one, I haven't had a chance to play that yet. We'll have to try that out before we know for sure. That one was just announced by our friends at the op. I do not plan on asking for a review copy of that one. I don't need After Dark games. Yes.
Okay, so, well, I think Farkle passes a test and is indeed a real game. It is not a game I want to be playing. It is not a game for me. That doesn't make it a bad game for other people. Pitch Car, right here behind me. You love that game. I never want to play that ever. Not unless there's a gun involved. I think there are some things out there that are called games that don't qualify as games. Well, some things that are being put in a box and called a game that are not in fact games.
I think it's interesting because one of the problems we run into is the popular definition of a game versus the actual definition of a game from the dictionary. Mm. So the dictionary definition of a game, the first definition of three is an activity providing entertainment or amusement, a pastime. And while our general definition doesn't include Candyland, that does.
Okay, so, but we're talking specifically about tabletop games, board games, or tabletop games at the very least, right? Like, by that definition, your definition would include me running outside and playing tag with my kids as a game. Yes. And it is, right? Well, it is. But it's a different type of game.
But it also includes Candyland, because it is an amusement or a pastime. It doesn't have what we consider things that are generally required in games like active decisions. And, you know, the difference between Candyland and Yahtzee is you make choices in Yahtzee.
Right? Yes.
And we often consider that, and we've talked about it in the past, how that is a feature of what makes something a game in our minds.
Which we probably should have talked about so people know what we think is a game before saying it doesn't fit our definition we haven't defined.
All right. Number one, as Sean just hinted at, players make choices, their choices affect the outcome of the game. I think a game needs player agency. Your actions and decisions have to matter in some fashion.
And I agree with that. I think you have to have a decision made for it to be considered a tabletop game, a board game.
Yeah, and by that definition, Candyland doesn't fit correct the dictionary definition of a game.
See, the dictionary definition of a game would qualify, I watch TV would be a game. Because there's nothing there about it being a game at all.
No, because watching TV isn't
a pastime.
Well, I think watching TV and Candyland are probably on the same level. I mean, Candyland has its place. It's an activity for children to do to learn colors and numbers. But it is not a game because it is just entirely, you have no choices and everything is just, you do the thing. You follow the path and do the thing from beginning to end. Snakes and Ladders has the same problem, right? Like there's no, it's just do to do to do to do. And by that argument, though, I have actually had an argument about this with our eldest daughter. Gelatinous, I think, is not actually a game. It is an activity. Mm-hmm. An activity that she enjoys doing, and she likes it, and she brings it to Board Game Club, but I would say it's not a game because there are no choices. You're just rolling your dice, stacking your dice, rolling your dice, stacking your dice. It's left, right, center. Left, right, center is not a game.
See, I agree with that. The only thing I want to get across that I think is important here is we're not saying games are better than activities. We're not saying that activities don't have value. We're not saying Candyland doesn't have value. We're not saying you can't have fun with Gelatinous because we watched it happen. We're not trying to say games are better. We're just trying to fulfill that definition because we were asked, is this a game? Now, I'm totally confused because I don't see how Farkle isn't a game. That's what kind of confused me. I think the question probably was, is Farkle a good game or do you consider it a good game? But as worded, it said, is Farkle a game? And I'm like, yes. Because the second thing,
is Farkle a real game? Which implies that there are
not real
lesser games out there. And I didn't, you know.
Yeah. And I think the real game goes to where we've talked about, you know, Candyland is not a real game, whereas Farkle is a real game.
Yeah.
I don't like that term real because, again, it implies real is better than unreal.
It does. It absolutely implies that. But we also get into the problem where, again, the dictionary definition indicates that Candyland and Farkle are both real games, whereas our definition of a game doesn't include Candyland.
We're throwing the dictionary out for the rest of the episode because I think we can all agree that we disagree with the game definition in the Webster's Dictionary is not how I feel tabletop games. Okay, so let's narrow it down to tabletop games.
Okay, the next thing I'm going to throw in is, to me, a game has structure, has rules. It is a structured form of play where everyone at the table is following a set of guidelines or restrictions, and part of being able to be part of that game is following those. If you do something that doesn't follow those, you're now playing against the game or out of the game. To me, one of the main definitions, and here Candyland still fits. It is structured play with a set of sequences to follow. It is organized. There are limitations. I think to me, that's a bigger part of what makes a game, or as big a part as being able to make decisions.
No, I agree. That was one of the things I had written down was there are rules, and the game most likely includes a rule book or a sheet of paper explaining the rules. And if you follow the rules, the game works. Like rule 4 doesn't make rule number 2 irrelevant or impossible. And there's where I feel that some games are not games, because if the rules contradict themselves and the game is broken, that's not a game. So is He-Man the RPG a game?
It's a game.
You can't actually play it rules as written. It is busted. Or
I think it's still a game. It's just a broken game.
I don't think it's incomplete. So it's not a product. I think is the bigger problem with Master of the Universe. Master of the Universe is not a finished product.
But no, again, it's a product.
It's like selling you Monopoly without the money.
I know there are other games we've run into this on, and I couldn't think of them. The only other one that came to my mind was Lone Wolf and Cub. Was a game that Mo had, or still has, I don't even know, when I first started dating him. And I remember I was like, oh my gosh, you have a Lone Wolf and Cub game. He's like, no, that's not a game. You can't actually play that. You can look at the art. Because it was broken. And back then we didn't have the internet to go find Narada and figure out how to fix it, right? So I'm like, a game where the rules literally make the game impossible to play is not a game.
To me, that's a broken game. The intent was there. There are supposed to be structure that works. It's all supposed to be there. It just someone's little baby, they didn't blind paid to play test, or there was an editing error, or there was a mistake made. To me, that's still a game. It's not a playable game, but to me, it's still a game.
Okay.
I don't know. I have a hard time saying if you can't play it, how can that be a game?
It's not a good game. It's a broken game. Like you have to qualify it.
Oh, I mean, and by that definition, isn't Candyland a broken game? It's not a good game.
It's not broken. There's just no decisions.
You can follow the rules as written and they work and they make sense and you get from point A to point Z in Candyland. So it is not a broken game. My concept is that a broken game is not a game. It doesn't qualify for a game if it's busted. And I mean, truly busted.
And I mean, the argument that some people would put forth, and Ryan says the lack of agency in Candyland is a feature, not a bug. But I mean, the shuffling of the deck is the player interaction within Candyland.
Yeah, but you don't make any decisions. It's still missing that decision point. I think you need a decision point. The other thing I think games need, though, are stakes. This could be you win or you lose. Those are probably the most basic. But it could also be like accomplishing an objective or getting everyone on the same page. Or it could be the entire group. You could have two teams and one team completes a thing and the other doesn't. There are other ways you can break it down. It doesn't necessarily have to be win or lose, but there has to be some kind of stakes. And there Candyland again wins. Like the only thing to me that's missing from Candyland is a decision point, which if people are going to argue a game, it's just to me not an interesting game. It's an educational tool. It's lots of other things, but by to me is I don't classify it as a game. I think it's a great tool. It's a learning opportunity. It's a piece of history. It's foundational. It drove other things. It's important. It just to me doesn't quite fit what I'd want to call a game. If someone said sit down and play a game, I expect to have something where I'm making decisions, and those decisions matter.
I called out Candyland because everyone knows Candyland and I know it's Sean's favorite game. But as a mom, I can say there are a lot of games that are put out for, you know, in the preschooler toddler set, there are a lot of games that are put out for kids that are not games.
Yes.
And I'm not going to make a list of them.
Ryan was asking if you can lose in Candyland. I'm like, technically, yes, because someone wins. Yep. Someone gets to the end first and they're declared.
Here's the question. So, I mean, Candyland is not a game. War, you know, the card game War, not a game. Under the exact same questions. So here's my question, though. If we take the game of life, there is one branching path in the game of life. If we take that branching path out, is it no longer a game?
I think there's other decision points
I haven't played that in a long time, but I think there's other decision points where you decide if you're going to act on a space that you land on.
Like if I remember those points where you can take out a loan and it's optional.
I would have to think. My thoughts were it was one of those you have to do something, and if you don't have enough money, you have to take out a loan. But like if you have a kid, you have a kid.
The answer is if there's a decision point, yes. If there isn't, then no. Either way, whatever the actual rules are.
I know it's got a branching path and you can choose path A and B, which gives it immediately makes it a game under this discussion. And I'm trying to remember whether or not if you take that branching path out, if
there's actually a couple branching paths in the original. I think there's two or three. But
I haven't played it in like 30 years. So
last one I played was the Star Wars version. So it was very different from the original.
I don't know. I think I pretty much hit the points I wanted to make. I don't think I won you over to my point of view. I figured at this point we could dip into what the chat room has to say about the topic, because I've been seeing some interesting stuff.
So again, Darkling Bite points out a game is an act that has an action to perform, and then there are at least basic concept or some rules or guidelines to follow. So that hits part of what I said. Like I said, I think there has to be guidelines, there has to be stakes, and there have to be decisions. I think to me, those are the three foundations of a game. I'm going to write a book on this or an essay. The three foundations of game designs to be a game. I'm not going to use the term real game. I won't use that term. Because again, that puts it on a plateau above activities. I won't even say you have to have a rule book, because we all learned how to play tag when we were kids. And that is very much a game that had rules. But I've never seen a tag rule book. Though the internet exists now, I'm sure there's a Wikipedia page.
There's a professional tag league, so there has to be
a rule book. Yeah, exactly. Okay, there have to be, but I'm just saying. I wanted to take it to tabletop games.
Here's an interesting question
that Roger poses that I think does actually impact this topic very strongly, and it impacts things we review. And that is, what is the difference between a puzzle and a game?
A puzzle has one solution. A game has multiple branching paths.
But, I mean, a game... In a large portion of the games, the end result is you win. It's you win or you lose.
Okay. Then I would say a puzzle is a subset of games that has a single solution, a single end point.
So by that definition, you're saying all of those mystery games we play, like from Mysterious Package Co., they're not games, they're puzzles?
Or puzzles are a subset. We're saying puzzles are a subset of games. So they're a type of game.
The type of game. Which is why we review them on the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming podcast.
Does that make a jigsaw puzzle a subset of a tabletop game?
There's no decision point. You can't do it wrong. It's a single path with no decision point. Whereas like a murder mystery or an escape room box, you're deciding what to manipulate, what to do. Oh, an escape box might also fit as just puzzle. But like murder mysteries, there usually are options. You have choices, you have ways to go, things to look at, different ways you can get to that final answer. While there's one final answer, there might be different ways to get to it, where a puzzle, the final answer is the completed puzzle.
So we're looking at the difference between a puzzle and a puzzle game, I think, is what we're coming down on.
I think you can't fail at a puzzle. I mean,
yes,
I guess you could start ramming the pieces in incorrectly, but like it's a predetermined set action. You're going to put these pieces together in this order to make this puzzle. Whereas when we play one of those mystery games, you end up sometimes following a dead end, going over here, thinking about this, and have to pull the pieces together to come up with an answer. That
Ryan makes an interesting comment where all games have a loss condition, but not always a win condition. So you can always lose, but there aren't always winners.
Dungeons and Dragons doesn't have a loss. Co-op games, yeah, some. I don't know, I guess Dungeons and Dragons, your whole party dies. That's why I was trying to allude to that there is a system for stakes, right? You have stakes in Dungeons and Dragons, but there is no way to win or lose Dungeons and Dragons. Well, technically, I can come up with lots of ways to lose Dungeons and Dragons, but those have to do with bad DMs and poorly designed games. Like, your character dying can be a loss condition in a role-playing game, but that's very D&D-specific thinking. I have played many games where that is not a loss condition.
Well, I mean, yes, but I mean, we talk a lot about player elimination in general, in all forms of games these days.
Oh, there, yeah. So Darkling Blight saying that they're a narrative shaped experience. Again, it's stakes. As long as there's stakes in the role-playing game. And to be fair, I've tried to play role-playing games without stakes and I don't enjoy them. And to me, those are just improv experiences, right? You can just be silly and it doesn't ruin the game. And once players realize that, like, if you got the right group, you can tell a great story together. But that's true of any improv experience or improv. Like, I guess some improvs are probably games, but versus or storytelling or sitting around and pass the stick and all of that.
Yeah. I mean, if you look at something like theater games, which are improv games, those are actually competitive improv things, mm-hmm. not cooperative improv systems like many modern, super modern, you know, hipster RPGs are. There is a difference because it's two teams competing in improv scenarios and not one group cooperating.
Farkle is a game. It fits all three requirements. Yeah, I want to know
why. Again, I guess it's the real clarification.
Yeah, it's the real. Like, I don't see why they consider Yahtzee a real game either, I'm sure.
And Gelatinous is not. So I can now cite this episode to win my argument with our child.
Yeah, but she might not agree with us anyway, seeing as she is 16.
And again, she can pull out the dictionary. So, because we have agreed that we are varying from the dictionary definition here. We have our own definition that is more narrow.
Does Board Game Geek define game?
That's a good question. I did not look into that.
Their guideline is, actually, this is kind of true. Kind of like porn. You know it when you see it, right? It's kind of true in a way for why it fits.
Is it a game? You'll know it when you see it. Is that their description?
Yeah, basically. Well, I that's what the summary was.
They don't have a straightforward definition at all. They have wisely, perhaps, avoided coming out and saying what is a game.
I will say all of those things we're claiming are not games are listed as games on BoardGameGeek. So if anything, they're going closer to the
dictionary definition. Yes.
Dictionary definition. And I got to say, thinking of it from that perspective, not that I'm going to totally change my mind here, but where else would you put Gelatinous?
Again, it's a hobby activity. Like, it's an activity.
Hobby activity. We need hobby geek.
It's an activity.
It's geek.
Flipping a coin. There's no difference between flipping a coin competitively and playing Gelatinous.
Flipping a coin competitive. What's the difference? Is that what you asked?
No, there is no difference.
There is none.
Yeah. That's, well, flipping a coin competitively, you no, there's winners and losers. Yeah.
it's literally flipping a
coin. It depends on if there's betting involved, because then as soon as you add betting, Gelatinous is a game.
Flipping a coin
choices.
Involves manual decks and is therefore more of a game than Gelatinous.
No, there's decks in Gelatinous. You got to stack those dice. I've seen people fail at this.
There is no player agency in either one, though. So
I give it to you.
No, there isn't. Like I said, until you throw in betting. Like LCR, I'm like, okay, a lot of people say LCR is a game, and then you're like, oh, they're betting on it. Well, of course, then it's a game.
Well, yeah, then the betting is the game, not
LCR.
That's your game. That's the, you know, you can bet on pig racing, and is pig racing a game? I don't really think so, but the betting you're doing for it is.
Is a game we don't like to mention a game the way most people play it? It does.
I don't know how most people play it. According to the rules, it's a game. There's meaningful choices, and there's voting. There's lots of choices.
Yeah. If you ignore the rules in a game, then you're off on your own, and you may or may not be depending on how it's chosen. But